Nancy, would you please call the roll?
Miller.
Here.
Benson.
Here.
Brown.
Here.
Valencia.
Present.
Fisher.
Here.
Leo.
Here.
Hannaford.
Here.
Item number four is a public hearing on the annexation of property. It's listed here in 8 separate tracts as described in our agenda. Jodan?
This is a public hearing on this, so it's if there's anybody in the audience that would like to make any comments or ask any questions.
Yeah, please introduce yourself and come forward.
My name is Eric Brewer. We own the VIP property south of Alva. We're involved with this annexation, and we are very, very much against being annexed into the city limits. Myself and several other landowners are not for this at all in the least. We feel that when this whole deal came about, that we were, I guess, more or less told that this was going to be, and that was going to be all there was to it, and we didn't appreciate that at all in the least. I guess you guys are going to do what you're going to do, but we're prepared to fight this deal tooth and toenail. That's all I have to say.
Okay, thank you, Eric. Anyone else? Larry, did you want to speak?
Larry Core. I'm not in city limits either. I just have some questions on how you're going to start doing the water bill and the garbage. And I know I'm going to pay city tax, but I'd just like to know, are our water meters all set on cubic feet? Are they set on gallons? Are we going to be charged for gallons? Are we going to be charged for cubic? How you gonna figure the garbage? Since I'm out of the city limits, I pay 1.5% over, or 115 or whatever it is percent above on the regular water bill. I'm not opposed completely to being in the city limits or out of the city limits. I didn't buy the property because it was out of the city limits. I bought it because that's where I wanted to build. Like I said, I just want to know how you're financing and how you're charging. I've heard some stories from city's employees and different things, and didn't know anything was right or wrong, so I haven't formed any opinions until I hear it from y'all. So I'll wait. I may have more questions later.
Well, I'll tell you, I'll talk about the water. I mean, if the annex goes through, if the council votes an annex, water bills will go down to what the city rates are.
And you will have a minimum?
There is a minimum already.
Well, it used to be years ago.
Yeah, there's a minimum now. And as far as the way it's calculated, our water right now is calculated on per cubic foot. But we have a mixture of gallon and cubic feet meters out there. So whether or not you have at your property right now would have a gallon or a cubic foot meter, I don't know. But right now there's a mixture of gallon and cubic feet meters. In the near future, we're looking at doing a water meter project that will convert all of those cubic feet meters to gallon meters. We'll redo our rate structure so that it's calculated on gallons, and we're going to be doing away with the cubic foot meters.
Well, surely you know the number.
The number?
How many gallons and how many cubic feet meters are out there?
No, I don't. I know how many meters I have out there. I have roughly about, 2,800 meters out there right now.
Okay.
And there's a mixture. When I've gone through my calculations, I wanted to know the number of meters. I didn't really care about what they were because I know my cubic feet meters are going to be going away.
So how are you going to charge until you get them replaced?
We will charge until all the meters are replaced. We're going to continue the rate structure that we've got.
Okay.
Once all of our meters are replaced, we will have a similar structure that is calculated off of a gallon meter, not a cubic foot meter.
That answers one of six.
The second one is your taxes won't go up.
I don't pay city taxes, so it'll go up.
No, there are no city taxes.
On property?
No.
No.
Well, that's another story.
Oklahoma is the only state in the union that does not allow cities to charge property tax.
Okay. I do make top count, so that's fine.
Yeah. But you had four more questions?
I'll ask later.
Okay. Anyone else? This is your opportunity during the public hearing to speak. If you have questions, this is a good time to do so. Gene? Rose?
Well, not really. I'm Gene Lynn. We've attended every meeting that we've had on this planning commission. And if things go as planning commission passed, we're happy with it. That's Rose and me.
Unless things change.
Okay, is there further discussion? Any more questions, comments? Norville, Bob? Glad to have you here this evening. Okay. That completes our public hearing, Counselor?
Yes, sir.
Item number five, discussion and action on the consent agenda. All of the following items which concern reports and items of a routine nature normally approved at city council meetings will be approved by one vote of the council. Any member of the council desiring to discuss an item on the consent agenda may request that it be removed from the consent agenda and placed for discussion on the next as the next item on the regular agenda. It will then be considered separately. The consent agenda consists of the consideration and action on the following items. A. Approval of the minutes of the regular meeting of November 17th, 2014. And B. Approval of claims in the amount of $63,368.63 plus payroll expenses of $167,751.80. Is there a motion that the consent agenda be approved?
So moved.
Motion by Miller?
Second.
Second by Fisher. Any discussion? Clerk may call the roll.
Miller?
Yes.
Fisher?
Yes.
Hannaford?
Yes.
Baird?
Yes.
Valencia?
Yes.
Brown?
Yes.
Simpson?
Yes.
Item number seven are reports from boards and officers. Let's start with Joe Don and the ARC meeting from 11-19.
Well, actually, I will let Councilman Fisher make any comments he would like to make, seeing as he is the council's representative on that committee.
There was really a pretty basic meeting. There wasn't much going on. We discussed trying to finish up the contracts, getting more questions. That was the discussion about renting the building out for a zoo class. Other than that, it was pretty basic.
Okay, item B, the tourism meeting from 11-19.
I was unable to attend that meeting, and I have not seen the minutes of it, but up for discussion, the one item that was up for discussion was for the approval or disapproval of funds for Northwest Oklahoma Show Pig Circuit, not to exceed $4,225, and I believe that was approved.
Item C is the Finance Committee report from this evening. Joe Don?
Well, I would first turn that over to either Councilman Miller as the chairman or Councilman Benson as a member of that committee and let them update the council on that meeting, and I'll fill in if they would like for me to.
We had the general items that we always have, signing claims. Spent the rest of the time discussing our purchasing ordinance that's on our agenda tonight, and discussing the refinance of the homestead note and funding the AMR project. We met with two gentlemen that are here tonight from the financial advisors group and from the bond attorneys, so that if anybody has questions.
So we'll have more on that when we, talk about the utility. Next is the city mayor's report, and I attended the Northwest Water Action Plan meeting in Fairview on the 25th. And a report from the city manager of Fairview says that they have high nitrates. As you know, the amount allowable by law by the DEQ is about 10.4 parts per million, and they're up over 9 parts per million. So they're going to have to look at reverse osmosis or some new wells. Then we had an update from the oil and gas industry by Kirk Shope from Select Energy and Mike Mathis from Continental Resources. And they talked about using and processing marginal waters, which, and of course, water is a huge cost component in the production of oil. Using non-potable water in the frack process is always an option, but he said that each well had different needs for the fracking chemicals, and as a result, it was hard to recycle water from one fracking process to another. But they're always looking for solutions to their water needs. Currently, the oil industry uses about 3% of the water in the state of Oklahoma, and they're expecting that amount to increase to 11% by 2060. So they need to look at using reuse and recycling and the use of marginal waters in that process. And that was the gist of the meeting, and the next meeting will be announced in December. Item E is the city business manager's report, and that's in your folder.
I've got a few items to report as far as the manager's report goes. We are looking at finalizing the purchase of two mobile generators for the water well field. We've evaluated two slightly used generators. One is a 2010 model with 1,700 hours. The other is a 2012 model with 3,800 hours. The package price for these generators will be $102,500, which is $37,500 less than what we had originally budgeted for these for the purchase of these items. The combined hours are approximately 5,500 hours, and when I've talked with the local electricians who help us in the well field, that is a very low usage for these for this equipment. Some of the other equipment that we looked at was new. It was going to cost somewhere in the neighborhood of about $68,000 per machine. Some of the used equipment that we looked at wasn't, if we bought it from the same company, wouldn't have the same engine for both machines, whereas these both come with Perkins diesel engines. The others were a little newer models. They were more in the 2012 range, but they had a whole lot more hours on them, and we felt like this was the best deal for the city of Alva. We opened bids on November 24th for the sanitation transfer station. There were two bidders on the revised project, Cedar Ridge General Contractors in Construction and Slattery Construction. Both of these bidders are from Woodward, and we're currently evaluating these bids. They were a little bit less than what we had received the first time. The low bid was a little bit less than what we had received the first time we bid it out. The next to the low bid was about at the same price range as what we'd bid out on the first one, the first time around. So we're still evaluating those bids. After satisfying the questions from the November 17th meeting, we did purchase the 2008 Sterling trash trucks. According to DOT regulations, there's nothing in it concerning air brakes for trucks under 26,000 pounds. This truck is under 26,000 pounds. It has a weight capacity that is where it's rated less than that. so a CDL driver will not be required. We are still advertising for a few employees, but not as aggressively as we have in the past few months. We've hired a couple new guys for the water department. We've hired about three new people for the sanitation department. And we're letting staff kind of get caught up on training these new hires to make sure we've got them all squared away. And Mayor and Council, that would be my report for this evening.
Also like to add to that that the need for housing is still critical. Landlords are receiving calls from families that want to move to Alva and bring their children, and housing for families is not available. We have a lot of transient workers who have found housing in everything from man camps to RVs to the local motels, but there is a definite need. So if you have any plans in your future for renovating a house that you might have that's currently unoccupied, that would be much appreciated by families that would like to move to Alva. Anything else for Joe Don from the council? If not, let's go to item number 8, which is discussion and action on ordinance number 2014-047, annexing certain territory to the city of Alva, Woods County, Oklahoma, and declaring an emergency. Of course, the territory to be considered for annexation is as listed in the 8 tracts in your packets. Is there any discussion?
Which path are we going? Are we doing the annexation under the majority of acres, the majority of land on it?
With the acreage that we have right now between the airport and the people that have signed consent agreements, we have in excess of 51% of the acreage consented on, so we would be doing with consent.
And you've reviewed that to make sure that Oklahoma statutes are followed and everything's
is correct
as presented.
Is there a motion then that this territory be annexed? Motion by Valencia.
Second.
Second by Benson. Any discussion? Clerk may call the roll.
Valencia.
Yes.
Benson.
Yes.
Hannaford.
Yes.
Miller.
Yes.
Fisher.
Yes.
Leo.
Yes.
Brown.
Yes.
Okay, motion passes. Item number 9.
No.
Emergency.
We have to declare an emergency. Is there a motion to declare an emergency?
So moved.
Motion by Benson.
Second.
Second by Hannaford. Any discussion? Clerk may call the roll.
Benson.
Yes.
Hannaford.
Yes.
Miller.
Yes.
Brown.
Yes.
Valencia.
Yes.
Fisher.
Yes.
Lael.
Yes.
Item number 9, discussion and action on ordinance number 2014-048, amending the city, Alva City Code of Ordinances by creating a new Article 5 of Chapter 26 of said code, prohibiting the possession and or use of tobacco products and electronic smoke devices on city-owned or operated property, providing for definitions, posting, providing punishment for violation of said section, providing for enforcement, repealer, and severability, and declaring an emergency. You can find the text of that code under tab number 9. And Joe Don, would you like to speak to that?
Based on the discussions that we had at a meeting on November 1st, the only thing that was changed in the ordinance from that presentation was in section 26-. -118, violation and penalty, and we've put in there any person who knowingly violates this article is guilty of a misdemeanor and upon conviction thereof shall be punished by a fine of $10 plus applicable court costs.
Okay, is there any further discussion on this proposed ordinance? not, is there a motion that?
I'd make a motion that we pass ordinance number 2014-48 to establish the city of Alva owned and operated property tobacco-free.
Okay, motion by Miller.
Second.
Second by Hannaford. Any discussion? Clerk, may call the roll.
Miller.
Yes.
Hannaford.
Yes.
Benson.
Yes.
Valencia.
Yes.
Fisher.
Yes.
Rayo.
Yes.
Brown.
Yes.
And declare an emergency. Is there a motion to declare an emergency?
Make a motion to declare an emergency.
Motion by Miller.
Second.
Second by Hannaford. Any discussion? Clerk, may call the roll.
Miller.
Yes.
Hannaford.
Yes.
Benson.
Yes.
Rayo.
Yes.
Valencia.
Yes.
Fisher.
Yes.
Rayo.
Item number 10, discussion and action on ordinance number 2014-049 relating to the creation of a purchasing policy, creating Article 6 of Chapter 20 of the City of Alva Code of Ordinances entitled Purchasing Policy, providing for processing methods and internal controls over municipal purchases and cash disbursements, and providing for repealer, codification, severability, and declaring an emergency. Joe Don, we've discussed this at length at the last meeting.
Yes, we did discuss this on November 17th, and based on those discussions, there were some modifications made to the ordinance. The modification that was made is in Section 20-2003, subsection C. For all purchases of purchases or contracts for goods, services, or capital, the persons listed in Exhibit A, except the business manager, shall be authorized to obligate the city up to the amount designated. One, up to $15,000, or the amount authorized on Exhibit A, whichever is amount is less. The designated purchasing officer will be allowed to obligate the city. Two, all purchases under $25,000, the city business manager will be able to obligate the city. And three, any amount over $25,000, city council approval shall be obtained prior to the time of the commitment is made, and such approval shall be recorded in the minutes of the council. Then if you refer back to Exhibit A, you'll see the positions that have been listed and the dollar amounts they would be able to purchase without any prior authorization other than ensuring that the purchase is a budgeted transaction.
With those changes having been made, is there a motion to approve this ordinance?
Can I ask a few questions since I wasn't
here? Sure.
So you as a city manager won't even sign off on any of these purchases?
No, I'll still be signing off on all of the purchases, but they won't have to come to me to get prior approval before they buy. Right.
You won't give any kind of prior approval for this. So do our, like the safety coordinator or the deputy clerk, are they privy to the budget to where they understand if
They are giving copies of the budget, and they are giving each department is giving a monthly update on where their budget is at.
And where did the figures come from, 25 and 15?
Well, 25,000, kind of give you an example, a load of fuel would be under $25,000. The purchase of most of any one transaction for our street purchasing would be under $15,000. Water line repair purchases would be under $15,000.
They still wouldn't get any kind of approval from you as a city manager. So ultimately, if there was a mistake made, who's ultimately responsible then?
If there is a mistake made, ultimately, I'm the one that's responsible.
Without approving a purchase of $15,000?
am I comfortable with the staff I have and at the current time?
I know there's probably people.
I mean, am I comfortable with them telling me the amount, then if they come, they communicate with me that they're going to be buying $8,000 worth of street material, or they were fixing to order that? Yeah, I'm comfortable with making sure that they have made that purchase in the proper manner.
So what would be the real difference of them communicating with you and saying, hey, I'm getting ready to buy $8,000 worth of equipment and just bringing you a purchase requisition for $8,000 for your signature?
What if I'm on vacation? What if I'm sick? And then they can't buy that when they need it. And it's a critical water line that needs to get replaced. Or a street project that's going to get held up for a week because I'm not available.
And there's nothing in the policy that would allow anybody else besides the department manager authorization to sign a purchase requisition for the city?
I guess we could make some changes in there where the mayor could sign off on it.
If I'm not mistaken, it's a state law that if you purchase anything over $50,000, you have to put it out for bid. Is that right, Joe Don?
If it's a public construction, if it is a public construction item, yes, it's bid out.
We have no policy right now, so anybody can go out and obligate us for anything under that right now. So with this ordinance, we're lowering that to these figures for those people.
I don't disagree with the reasoning, and I understand it's pre-budgeted and we've approved the budget. I just know if you had seven of these people do $15,000 and just four mistakes were made, just mistakes, they thought they had the money or they thought misread something, that's a lot of money. All I'm saying is one person just checking, just to check some balances to make sure that, yeah, we have the money budgeted for that. That's all I'm saying.
Okay. Well, let me ask you, at what level do you think it would be acceptable for them to be able to make a purchase?
I don't know. The numbers, that's probably the biggest thing that surprised me is the amount.
A load of oil for our streets cost $8,000 or $9,000. Water line to repair, we're looking at repairing water line up on Linden Street, replacing that line. The water line itself is going to be in the neighborhood of $10,000 to $11,000.
I understand that.
Do I know about those? Yes. Do I know when they are about to run out of fuel? No. We make fuel purchases about once every 2 months.
But your department head would know in advance. I think I'm just concerned about the oversight process, and I think this allowing department heads a $15,000 threshold to buy goods and services without prior authorization, and for me allowing the assistant directors up to $5,000 with no prior authorization is just not, in my opinion, exercising the oversight that we need.
And again, I guess my question would be, because we haven't talked about this, at what level would you be comfortable with?
I'm not opposed to the numbers if I knew you were checking up and signing off on it. I'm not against anything about this as long as somebody was signing off on it.
I mean, I will eventually sign off on every purchase order that comes through.
think Joe Don's answered it. He's ultimately responsible. Council hired Joe Don. We're putting that responsibility on him. He's already accepted that. We keep arguing what we're going to do as far as amounts. We've presented amounts. If you want different amounts, say them now so that we can change it. But if we don't know amounts, we're just going to sit here and keep talking about the same thing. I mean, if that's too high, present a number that you think that you're comfortable with. To me, Joe Don has already spoken about he's comfortable with the department heads he's got with these numbers. He's ultimately responsible for those dollar amounts.
And these dollar amounts are approved annually. I mean, and these levels are approved annually. If we see that it's not working, we change them. The oversight that you say you're concerned about, I'm not sure how to increase that oversight without hampering the department's ability to get the job done. And that's what we weighed when we went into this, is at what level and how did we do that, and how do we make this where it's workable and still be able to get the job done in a timely manner.
And I think, Mark, Steve, a lot of this, these same department heads have been making purchases larger than that for years without any problems. And every purchase they make is a budgeted item that we've approved. We approved the street department can spend so much money on, on street materials. If he wants to buy $15,000 at one time, I don't think we need to stand over his shoulder and make sure he's buying the correct materials at the correct time. We've got a street department supervisor that's in the know of when to buy that and how much. I think we need to give him the authority to do that when he deems necessary, as opposed to going through all these steps and waiting, and then now he's waiting an extra, if Joe Don happens to be out of town, 2, 3, 4, 5 days to get that job done. We're setting limits, and I think he's right. We can relook at it every year. We could redo it more often than that, I'm sure, if we absolutely had to. But the bottom line is they've had authority to do much more than that. Now we're setting an actual limit.
And Joe Don, is this common practice in other communities?
The prototype for this ordinance was actually developed by Crawford and Associates from Edmond, and they're a premier municipal accounting firm and consulting firm within the state of Oklahoma. They have written most of the laws, or a lot of the financial laws that state legislative has passed as they concern to municipalities. And the model for this, except for the limits that we've put in here in Section C, is verbatim what they recommend. And what we have put in there is in Section C is actually more restrictive than what their model ordinance was.
Any other questions or comments? Bo?
And I don't think nobody's opposed to. Obviously, if you have a suggestion on a different amount, I mean,
I'm not against amount. I would like Joe Don to initial and sign it with it just to get it approved.
And you recognize today that doesn't occur.
Yeah.
Without the ordinance,
which,
already.
I'll be honest with you, surprises me.
Yeah.
As well, as a newer council member. So, I mean, I applaud what we're trying to do, and I understand what we're trying to do. I've been charging budgets, and 7 people underneath me that still have to get approval. I have to get approval if I spend money, even though it's pre-budgeted.
And this would be the same process. I mean, there is a level that they don't have to get approval at, and the levels were set because of the dollar amounts that we purchase for materials. I mean, up to a certain amount, you know, anything over $25,000, this council still has to approve before it's bought.
And like I said, I understand. I believe we've got competent people, but what if one of them leaves and then we get somebody that shows that they're not?
That's when we take the corrective action, either one, to eliminate that person because they weren't doing their job and they weren't showing the fiduciary responsibility over their budget that they should have been, or we make changes to the levels at which they can purchase that.
Any further discussion? Is there a motion then that this ordinance number 2014-049 relating to the purchasing policy be approved?
I make a motion to approve ordinance 2014-009 for the City of Alva purchasing ordinance.
Motion by Benson.
Second.
Second by Lael. Any discussion?
You said 009-049.
0049.
Zero.
I didn't hear the four. I'm not sure I said.
I meant to say a four there.
No, but did you second it there?
Any further discussion? Clerk may call the roll.
Benson?
Yes.
Lael?
Yes.
Valencia?
No.
Fisher?
Yes.
Miller?
Yes.
Hannaford?
No.
Yes.
Okay. Motion passes. Item number 11. Say again. Oh, the emergency clause. Yes, is there a motion that an emergency be declared?
So moved.
Motion by Benson.
Second.
Second by Miller. Any discussion? Clerk may call the roll.
Benson?
Yes.
Miller?
Yes.
Hannaford?
No.
Fisher?
Yes.
Lael?
Yes.
Brown?
Yes.
Item 11, discuss and vote to approve resolution number 2014-091, authoring application for financial assistance from the REIT fund. That'll be under tab number 11. Is there going to be some money available this year from?
Our ability to tap into this REIT fund will be at about the same level that it has been, $50,000 in the past. Over the past couple of years, of course, 1 year we were not awarded the REAP grant. This past year, the $50,000 went toward street improvements. This application process, we're going to be looking to replace water line between the 200 and 400 blocks of East Sealing Street. This water line in this area has been a hindrance for maintenance. There has numerous maintenance issues in the past and needs to be replaced. It's basically a 2-inch line that needs to be upgraded. We can't repair the streets in this area at this time because of the likelihood and the frequency of water line breaks and us having to dig that up. So that will be our application for this year.
And that will be in the amount of $50,000?
Yes, it will be in the amount of $50,000. The project cost is well above that. The project cost at now, well, project cost right now is estimated in at a little over $100,000.
So this will help defray part of that expense. Okay, is there a motion then authorizing the application for this REAP grant?
Make a motion to approve resolution 2014-091 authorizing application for financial assistance from the REIT fund.
A motion by Miller.
Second.
Second by Hannaford. Any discussion? Clerk may call the roll.
Miller?
Yes.
Hannaford?
Yes.
Valencia?
Yes.
Benson?
Yes.
Lael?
Yes.
Brown?
Yes.
Fisher?
Yes.
Item number, see if that doesn't have an emergency. Item number 12, consider and take action with respect to resolution number 2014-092 of the City of Alva, Oklahoma, the city approving the incurrence of indebtedness by the Alva Utility Authority, issuing its utility system revenue note, taxable series 2014A, and its utility system revenue note, series 2014B, providing that the organizational document creating the authority is subject to the provisions of the indenture authorizing the issuance of 2014A note and the 2014B note, waiving competitive bidding with respect to the sale of the 2014A note and the 2014B note, and approving the proceedings of the authority pertaining to the sale of the 2014A note and the 2014B note, ratifying, confirming a lease agreement and operation and maintenance contract pertaining to certain water, sanitary sewer, and solid waste management systems, establishing the city's reasonable expectation with respect to the issuance of tax-exempt obligations by or on behalf of said city in calendar year 2014, and designating the 2014B note as a qualified tax-exempt obligation and containing other provisions relating thereto. That's under tab number 12. Joe Don, that relates to our electronic meter reading system and refinancing at the homestead. Is that correct?
That is correct. And actually, we have with us tonight Worley Atkins from the Municipal Finance Group, and Nate Ellis with the Public Finance Law Group. And if they would like to, if Worley would like to maybe speak to the note a little bit, then I'd certainly let him.
Well, good evening. My name is Worley Aiken. I'm with Municipal Finance Services, and our firm serves as an independent financial advisor out of Edmond. I've been with Rick's firm for 12 years, and we represent municipalities, rural water districts, colleges, universities, school districts on debt issuance and financing. Over the last couple of years, we've continued to monitor your 2005 bond issue that's outstanding to see, based upon current market and interest rates, if there was any availability for savings. Interest rates are considerably low today. I know the Fed has kind of promised to keep the Fed funds rate at a near zero level for quite some time, and interest rates are at about near historic lows. Based upon that, we looked at your 2005 bonds and refinancing them to save you money. In conjunction with this, Joe Don had mentioned that you had this AMR project. So we have a financing plan, and I'll pass this out. Together a packet that we have submitted to your local banks, as well as a bank in North Carolina that becomes very aggressive upon these types of transactions. And we've received some bids. If you turn to page one, I won't go through every number in this, but as I go through this, if you have any questions, please stop and interrupt me, and I'll be happy to answer those. Page one, this is your 2005 bonds, and this is the remaining debt service on those bonds. There's $1,730,000 outstanding. These have been advanced refunded once before. Under the current IRS regs, we're only allowed one tax-exempt advanced refunding. Therefore, the portion of the refinancing that we're going to look at in this report would be a taxable financing. Your AMR project would be a tax-exempt financing, and we'll get into that here in a second. But your current rate on your existing bonds is about 4.9% that we show at the bottom of the page there. And your maximum annual payment is about $272,000 annually. Page two, what we would do is we would set up an escrow upon closing. If this is approved, this would actually close next Tuesday, and escrow would be established to the fees or payoff your 2005 bond issue, and that's what we show on page two. The net funds required, the gross escrow funds required to make the remaining principal and interest payments through the call date of July 1st, 2015 is about $1,813,547.50. When you did the 2005 bond issue, there was actually a reserve fund set up with that issue of about $269,560 that would be applied to the principal outstanding. Each month, you also make principal interest payments to a trustee bank that makes those bond payments for you semi-annually. And you have funds in those accounts that we show there of the $92,500 and the $41,776 that would be applied to the gross deposit. So the net required to the fees or pay off your 2005 bonds would be $1,409,710.11. Page three, we received bids originally from BB&T, and then last Tuesday, your local bank, Alva State Bank, Todd Holder, had contacted us and expressed interest. We had sent all the local banks' information, your auditor financials, and our financial analysis as well that they had looked at. And Alva State Bank last Tuesday indicated that they would like to bid on this. Page three, what we show here is there's, again, two notes. On the left-hand side here, we show the taxable portion. That would be $1,465,000 to the fees, the 2005 bonds. And on the right-hand side, you would borrow $935,000 of new money for the AMR project, and that would be a tax-exempt note. BB&T bid at 3.09% on the taxable portion. They did have a call provision in there on or after July 1st, 2018, on any payment date at par. And on the $935,000 for the AMRs, they bid at 2.82%. Alva State Bank bid at 3% on the taxable 2014 A note. And on the tax-exempt series 2014 B note, they bid a 2.80%, so they were lower on both notes. The interest, the aggregate interest cost difference in the right-hand column that we show is about $6,400, so they're really competitive in on their bids. Are there any questions up to this point? Page four, this is a kind of a totality summary page of the whole transaction. Just starting from the top, again, the taxable portion would be the refunding portion of your 2005 bonds, par amount of $1,065,000. The tax-exempt portion would fund the AMR project in the amount of $935,000. Alva State Bank was a low bidder, and our recommendation on both notes. The interest rate on the 2014A taxable note on the refunding portion is a 3% fixed rate, and on the tax-exempt portion for the AMR project is 2.8%, and that is a fixed rate also. The taxable portion matures July 1st, 2021, and the tax-exempt portion, the 2014B note for the AMR project, would mature January 1st, 2025. We'll look at some detailed schedules here in just a second. About midway down the page, the purpose of these two notes would be, one, to advance refund the 2005 refunding revenue bond series 2005. The second purpose is to fund the water system improvements, the AMR water meter project. And third, to pay cost of issuance associated with the transaction. The security for the notes would be a pledge of your water, sewer, and trash revenues. There would be a debt coverage requirement annually, which you currently have on your bond issue right now, that your net revenues available for debt service annually would be 1.25 times or 125% of your annual debt payment. Again, not only did Alva State Bank have the lower interest rates, they also had the better call provision or prepayment provision, because you can prepay either of these notes at any time at par with no premium or penalty. And with me tonight is Nate Ellis from the Public Finance Law Group. They serve as your bond counsel. Our firm serves as your financial advisor. Rick Cunningham, of course, he is your local attorney that works with Nate in their office on the legal side of the documents. Bank of Oklahoma, who is your current trustee bank, would also be the trustee on this issue. And like I said, if approved, this will close next Tuesday, December 9th. Page five, this is an allocation between the refunding portion and the new money portion of the sources and uses of proceeds. And on the far right-hand column there, you see the total sources of funds, about $2.8 million. You're actually going to borrow $2.4 million because you have available cash to apply to the sources needed, to the funds needed. And then on the bottom part of the page there, we show the uses of the funds. So we would have the escrow of $1,813,547.50 that we looked at on the escrow analysis previously. Your project funds for the AMR project would be $902,615. Then you have cost of issuance, the bond council, financial advisor, local council, purchaser council, and that's for the bank's attorneys to review documents. Your escrow and trustee and rounding cost. Are there any questions at this point? Page six, this is the detailed structure of the two notes. Our intent here, on the left-hand side is the refunding portion. So this is the refunding of the 2005 bonds, the taxable portion. At 3%, based on the bid by Alva State Bank, this would mature July 1st, 2021. So you pay principal and interest until 2021 on this note. At that time, on the right-hand side, we show the 2014 B note for the AMR project. We're deferring principal on that note. Our idea was to keep your debt payments about the same as what you're currently paying. Right now, you're paying about $272,000 a year on your 2005 bonds. By deferring principal, you pay interest only on the new money portion. And then beginning in July of 2021, when the refunding portion pays off, you begin making principal payments on the new money portion. On the right-hand side, the far right column, the aggregate payments, your payment would be about $275,000 to $280,000 a year. So it's a slight increase over what you're currently paying, but we kept it at nearly the level that you're currently paying on your 2005 bonds alone. And again, this is a 3% and a 2.8% that was bid by Alva State Bank. Are there any questions? Page 7 and 8, these are just some calculations that we go through. Page 7, this is based upon the refunding only. This does not include anything to do with the new money, but this is a savings analysis that we look at how much you're saving on your 2005 bonds by paying them off through the escrow. So on the left-hand side there, we show your 2005 bond payments if you were to leave it in place. And in the middle column, we show the 2014A, the refunding note. And then we show the payment difference on the far right-hand column, the annual increase or decrease. And at the bottom there, around where the box is, what we show is you pay $507,311.67. We apply to that reserve fund for the 2005 bonds and the monies in your debt service fund. And so in gross savings, comparing principal and interest to principal and interest, you're going to save about $107,000 by doing the refunding. In the bottom box, it's just another calculation we go through to look at net present value savings. And it's about 1.6% of your principal outstanding. Page 8, this is comparing the two notes, your existing payment on the bonds and the proposed payment on the two notes. And basically, the bottom box down there, the $149,642.49, this simply means that that's what it's costing you to borrow $900,000. This is kind of a very simplistic way of looking at it over the life of the two notes out through 2025. So you're getting $902,000 in project funds, and it's costing you $149,000 to do that. The last several pages, these are the bids, the actual bids by BB&T Bank, as well as correspondence with Alva State Bank on their bid. And the last three or four pages are just some verification calculations that we run through different financial programs to verify the numbers that I just showed. have any questions for me, I'll be happy to answer those. If not, I'll let Nate talk about the resolution and all the stuff that you read.
Am I reading correctly that through refinancing, you'd be able to cut the year off, payment on the retirement center bonds?
Yes, sir.
You'd put a year off.
Are you on page seven?
Yeah, page one.
Yes, sir.
Six, actually.
Yeah, if you left your 2005 bond in place, they pay off in 2022. Now, your reserve fund will make that last payment.
Right.
And so that's why in our calculation down there by the box, we take that reserve fund into consideration as well as what's in your debt service fund, the principal interest that's been deposited through December. But yes, sir, you are cutting the year off of your other proof of maturity.
And then we're paying interest only on the AMR note, 2014B, until the year 2021.
Yes, sir.
And then at that time, we start paying off on the principal on it, and both notes will then be amortized by 2025?
25, yes, sir. Well, your 2014A note, the refunding portion, will truly pay off in 2021.
Does everyone understand that? We've got an interest-only note on the AMRs while we're amortizing the retirement center.
And, you know, when the financial information we submitted to the banks, we talked about this 1.25 times debt cover. That's really an industry standard. And what that means is if in a year, if you have a $100,000 debt payment to make, you'll need to show $125,000 in net revenues available to make that payment. So it's your payment plus a 25% cushion. Your debt coverage right now is about 3.7 times. It's really strong. And that helps us get, you know, better interest rates just based on financial criteria. Any more questions for me? Over to Nate.
Good evening. I'm Nate Ellis, Public Finance Law Group. Mr. Bond Counsel, just real quickly, the comment you made on the interest only. And one of the things that Rick and Worley looked at is what's kind of the best way to do this transaction of refunding the debt and providing the funds for the AMR project. That makes sense. If you have a taxable rate, that's going to be a higher rate over a given term than a tax-exempt rate would be over the same term. So we wanted to try and keep the taxable side as short as we could and defer principal on the tax-exempt side to try and keep those rates balanced while at the same time not increasing your payments any more than we had to. So the result is your average annual payment's only going up $5,000 to $10,000 a year and you're still able to fund the entire project. But that's why it's deferred like that, is when you look at the aggregate of interest only plus the principal and interest on the refunding, that amount is just a slight bit higher than your existing debt service. And then as soon as the taxable piece falls off, you start paying a much higher principal amount, again, keeping a level debt service when you look at the two combined. So, but this structure basically provided the lowest net cost of funds. We could have done it where both of them were amortized on a more level basis, but you would have had a much higher rate on the taxable side, a little bit lower rate on the tax-exempt side. In the aggregate, you would have had a greater interest cost overall. So that's why it's structured that way.
And I think it makes sense to get the AMR because, as we know, we have a mixture of water meters around town, and historically, when AMR system is installed, you actually meter the water more accurately, and in the long run, it's supposed to pay for itself. So that's, we'll wait to be seen, but as Alva grows, we'll hopefully need additional meters. We'll see. Any other questions for Nate? Any questions for Nate?
The resolution you have in front of you, the public trust, the utility authority, is the one that actually would be the issuer of the note. there was a separate resolution on their agenda that actually authorizes the issuance of the note and sets out all of the terms and approves all the documents. This resolution approves the actions to be taken by the utility authority as is required by public trust statutes. The beneficiary must approve the actions taken by a public trust in the case of a debt issue.
Anything else? Thank you very much. Is there a motion then that this resolution 2014 dash, well, before we do that, Finance Committee, you've reviewed this?
We have.
Counselor?
We have reviewed.
Is there a motion then that this resolution be approved?
Make a motion to approve resolution 2014 dash 092.
Second.
Motion by Miller, second by Benson. Any discussion? Clerk may call the roll.
Miller.
Yes.
Benson.
Yes.
Hannaford.
Yes.
Fisher.
Yes.
Lael.
Yes.
Brown.
Yes.
Valencia.
Yes.
Thank you very much, gentlemen. Is there an emergency clause?
No, it's just a resolution.
Number 13, discussion and action on the establishment of zoning for recently annexed property as described in your agenda, and you will find those proposed zones under tab
13.
Highlighted in yellow on pages 4 and 5 of that section. And these have come as a recommendation from the Planning Commission, Joe Don?
Yes. On October 27th, the Planning Commission met to discuss zoning for property, which we were anticipating annexing into the city of Alva. We sent letters to all the property owners affected by the annexation requesting them if they would like to have comments on their zoning or to see how we as city staff would recommend to the Planning Commission for zoning for them to come in and make comments. Several of them did. And those comments were taken into consideration as we went through our zoning recommendation. On the 27th, the Planning Commission did approve the recommendation to move forward to the council should the annexation take place. And each individual property is listed. When we're voting on this, we would need to approve the zoning as presented with existing legal nonconformities. There would be some for our ordinances, there would be some nonconformities that we would need to grandfather in. And that is the comments I have on this. I'd be happy to answer any questions that you may have, or Councilman Miller was at the Planning Commission meeting. He may be able to recall. It's been some time now, but he may be able to recall some of those questions and some of those comments and make any comments or be able to answer any questions that I can't.
Yeah, we didn't have anybody there that requested anything different or that had mentioned that they would rather it be one way or the other. The general commercial is really open to a lot of things. I mean, you can have houses in general commercial if you want. The only changes that I think we made from the original were the light manufacturing, where the Alva Concrete, I believe, is going to be. We made that a light manufacturing for them. And then the RG, General Residential, on the boulevard where the water tower is, that had at first been labeled differently, and it was moved to change that to General Residential
And so if you choose to make the motion, you need to include the statement that, that the property is, will be annexed, will be zoned as presented with existing legal nonconformities. Is that correct?
And the reason that is primarily for Western Equipment Company, because their zoning says that you can't have tractors and that type of equipment out unless it's being used for farming. And of course, they have this amount of equipment they need to set out on the highway for sale. So
in general commercial?
In that zoning, that,
So we don't want to restrict their ability to do business, and that's the purpose of the phrase, presented with existing legal nonconformities. Is there a motion then that this zoning be approved?
I move to approve the zoning for recently annexed property as presented with existing legal nonconformities.
Motion by Valencia.
Second.
Second by Miller. Any discussion? Clerk may call the roll.
Valencia?
Yes.
Miller?
Yes.
Vincent?
Yes.
Brown?
Yes.
Fisher?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Item number 14, discuss and vote to authorize the mayor to sign a right-of-way easement to Atlas Pipeline, Mid-Continent, West Oak, LLC, in the south half of the southwest quarter of Section 35, Township 27 North, Range 14 West, as approved by the Airport Commission. That's under tab number 14, and this is an easement for a pipeline from one of the wells, Joe Don?
Yeah, this will be an easement for a pipeline for approximately 33.64 rods in length. Atlas has proposed paying $120 per rod for this easement. The easement would be 50 feet in width during construction and revert to a 20-foot permanent easement. This item was discussed at the November 10th Airport Commission meeting and approved to be recommended to this council.
Recommend approval. Is there a motion then?
For the mayor's signature.
Yes. Is there a motion then to authorize the mayor to sign this right-of-way agreement? Motion by Lale.
Second.
Second by Hennifer. Any discussion? Clerk may call the roll.
Lale?
Yes.
Hennifer?
Yes.
Miller?
Yes.
Valencia?
Yes.
Brown?
Yes.
Fisher?
Yes.
Benson?
Yes.
Item number 15, remarks and inquiries by citizens. Hearing none, are there any remarks or inquiries by council members? Hearing none, this meeting is adjourned and we will open the meeting of the Utility Authority with the call to order and the roll call by Nancy.
Miller.
Yes.
Here. Benson.
Here.
Brown.
Here.
Valencia.
Here.
Fisher.
Yes.
Lale.
Yes.
Hannaford.
Here.
We have a quorum. Item number 3, discussion and action on the consent agenda. All of the following items, which concern reports and items of a routine nature, normally approved at AUA meetings, will be approved by one vote of the authority. Any trustee desiring to discuss an item on the consent agenda may request that it be removed from the consent agenda and placed for discussion as the next item on the regular agenda. It will then be considered separately. The consent agenda consists of the consideration and action on the following items. A, approval of the minutes of the regular meeting of November 17, 2014, and B, approval of claims in the amount of $83,557.61 and payroll expenses of $37,497.22. Is there a motion that the consent agenda be approved?
So moved. Second.
Motion by Hannaford, second by Miller. Any discussion? Clerk may call the roll.
Hannaford.
Yes.
Miller.
Yes.
Benson.
Yes.
Valencia.
Yes.
Fisher.
Yes.
Lale.
Yes.
Brown.
Yes.
Item number 5, consideration and take action with respect to resolution number 2014-093 as enumerated in the agenda.
This is a companion item to the 2014-092 resolution, which actually authorizes the borrowing of the money.
Which had to be approved by the council before the approval by the...
Make a motion to approve resolution number 2014-093.
Motion by Benson.
Second.
Second by Fisher. Any discussion?
To award sale of the notes to Alva State Bank at a rate of 3% on the 2014-8 note and 2.8%.
Thank you, Counselor.
Do I need to modify my motion, Counselor?
That, I think all that's set forth in the actual resolution.
It is.
But that's clarification for what the council is voting on.
Any further discussion?
Three, he gets the big money. See that?
Don't want to leave any stone unturned. Clerk may call the roll.
Brown.
Yes.
Fisher.
Yes.
Hannaford.
Yes.
Miller.
Yes.
Lamb.
Yes.
Benson.
Yes.
Valencia.
Yes.
That's the last item on that agenda. So let's close that meeting and open the meeting of the Economic Development Authority with the call to order and the roll call. Nancy?
Brown.
Here.
Hannaford.
Yes.
Lale.
Yes.
Miller.
Yes.
Benson.
Yes.
Valencia.
Yes.
Fisher.
Yes.
Item number 3, discussion and action on the consent agenda. All of the following items, which concern reports and items of a routine nature normally approved at AEDA meetings, will be approved by one vote of the board. Any trustee desiring to discuss an item on the consent agenda may request that it be removed from the consent agenda and placed for discussion as the next item on the regular agenda. It will then be considered separately. The consent agenda consists of the consideration and action on the following items. A, approval of the minutes of the regular meeting of November 17, 2014, and approval of claims in the amount of $26,872.23 and payroll expenses of $11,984.96. Is there a motion that the consent agenda be approved? Motion by Valencia.
Second.
Second by Hannaford. Any discussion? Clerk may call the roll.
Valencia.
Yes.
Hannaford.
Yes.
Lale.
Yes.
Fisher.
Yes.
Brown.
Yes.
Miller.
Yes.
Benson.
Yes.
This meeting is adjourned.